Hello, class. Before we begin, let us start our day with a prayer. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen and amen. Okay. So today, class, our discussion will focus on a special law. Okay? RA 9160, otherwise known as the Anti-Money Laundering Act of 2001. Okay? So, today, we will be discussing the revised implementing rules and regulation of RA number 9160 as amended. Okay? So, this implementing rules and regulation was introduced on 2016. So, without further ado, let us begin. First question, what is the purpose of AMLA? Okay? So, the meaning of AMLA is Anti-Money Laundering Act. So, for brevity, we will call this law AMLA. Okay? So, what is the purpose of AMLA? So, AMLA investigates money laundering and other financial crimes to protect financial institutions and deter criminals from making the Philippines a money laundering site for criminal proceeds. Okay? So, the purpose of AMLA, class, is to be the regulating body in order to know if whether or not transactions are made or the proceeds of such transactions comes from illegitimate or illegal sources. So that is why AMLA was enacted in order to protect the financial institutions and other financial environment, okay, like insurance companies, and companies that their business is concerned with finances. So, Title 1 of Rule 1 of this law, which is AMLA, provides that this implementing rules and regulation shall be known as the 2016 Revised Implementing Rules and Regulation of RA number 9160 as amended. Rule number 2 are the declaration of policies. Okay, so more often than not, class, declaration of policy are found under the Constitution. Okay, so it's like the guiding principle. Before laws are enacted, they must be in consonance with the Constitution. So more often than not, declaration of policy are embedded, okay, in the organic law. So number 2, let's read the declaration of policy. So it is hereby declared the policy of the state to protect and preserve the integrity and confidentiality of bank accounts and to ensure that the Philippines shall not be used as a money laundering site for the proceeds of any unlawful activity. Okay? So, what are these unlawful activity class? For example, illegal drugs, okay? Proceeds of illegal drugs, proceeds of illegal gambling, okay? Proceeds of a crime like extortion, and so on and so forth, okay? So, consistent with this foreign policy, the Philippines shall extend cooperation in transnational investigations and prosecutions of persons involved in money laundering activities wherever committed, okay? So, this law class is not only applicable to its residents or its citizens, but this is an international law in cooperation with other countries because we are signatory of different treaties that sanctions money laundering, okay? That is why we have a Money Laundering Act because this is in consonance with treaty stipulations also, okay? Because we are signatory. Rule 3. Now, let's go to definition of terms. So, for purposes of this implementing rules and regulations, the following terms are hereby defined as follow. Okay? So, first, Anti-Money Laundering Act. So, this refers to Republic Act number 9160 as amended by Republic Act number 9194. 10.16.7 and 13.10.365. Okay, so these are provisions class added to the original act. Okay, in order to expand its definition, it expand its prosecuting arm, and introduced other legal ideas and terms. Okay, in order to make this law as comprehensive as possible. Next is the Anti-Money Laundering Council or AMLC. So this refers to the Financial Intelligence Unit of the Republic of the Philippines, which is the government agency tasked to implement the AMLA. Okay, so AMLC or the council is the primary agency which implement the laws of AMLA. Next is supervising authority. So this refers to the Banco Central ng Pilipinas or BSP, the Securities and Exchange Commission or SEC, the Insurance Commission or IC, and the relevant regulatory bodies of the designated non-financial businesses and professions enumerated under Rule 3, E, 4, or other government agencies designated by law. Okay, so the supervising authority are also given responsibilities as members. Okay, so they are the partner agencies of the council. Next, who is a person? So this refers to any natural or juridical person. So when you say natural persons, these are persons like ourselves, living persons. In the other hand, when you say juridical persons, these are persons which are by virtue of a law, they are given personality. For example, corporations, financial institutions, and so on and so forth. Next, what are covered person? Okay, covered persons refers to the following. Number one, persons supervised or regulated by the Banco Central ng Pilipinas, such as. So, the following class are the juridical persons. So, they are persons by operation of law. Okay, like corporations, like banks, or non-banks, quasi-banks, trust entities, pawn shop, non-stock savings and loan associations, electronic money issuers, and all other persons under subsidiaries and affiliates supervised or regulated by the Banco Central ng Pilipinas. Okay, so they are juridical persons, okay, financial institutions where the implementing rules and regulation of AMLA can be applied. So, for the purposes of this implementing rule and regulation, foreign exchange dealers, money changers, and remittance and transfer companies are covered persons under the regulation of the Banco Central ng Pilipinas. Okay? So, even natural persons who are into business with finances, they are also covered. Next, persons supervised or regulated by the insurance commission, such as insurance companies, pre-need companies, insurance agents, insurance brokers, professional reinsurers, reinsurance brokers, holding company system, mutual benefit association, and all other persons and their subsidiaries and affiliates supervised or regulated by the insurance commission. Okay, so by the way, class, this reference, I will upload this in your file so that while you listen to this video lecture, you can be guided. Okay, so use this as a reference while you listen to my lecture. Okay, now, persons supervised or regulated by the security, by SEC. Okay, what's the meaning of SEC? I forgot. Security and Exchange Commission. Okay, so the following are sanctioned persons: securities dealers, brokers, salesmen, investment houses, and other similar persons managing securities or rendering services such as investment agents, advisors, or consultants. Okay, so the common denominator, class, of all persons or juridical persons is that in their business, they handle financial transactions. Okay, because sometimes the letters of the law are very technical. Okay, and these are just guidelines for you police officers, so that you will have working knowledge on the law of AMLA. Okay, next, mutual funds or open-ended investment companies, closed-end investment companies, or issuers and other similar entities. And then other entities administering or otherwise dealing in commodities or financial derivatives based thereon, valuable objects, cash substitute, and other similar monetary instruments or properties supervised and regulated by the SEC. Okay, so the common denominator, class, is the monetary part or the financial part of business of these institutions. Okay, next, the following designated non-financial businesses and professions, okay, like jewelry dealers, dealers in precious metals, and dealers in precious stones. Okay, so under the law, dealer is defined as an individual or entity who buys and or sells precious metals, precious stones, and or jewelry in the course of its business activities. The purchase or sales of precious metals, precious stones, and or jewelry as referred to herein excludes those carried out for connected with or for the purpose of extracting precious metals or precious stones from a mine, or cutting or polishing precious stones. Okay, so dealers are individual who are into the business of selling jewelries, okay, selling precious stones. Next, what is a jewelry? So this refers to finished goods deriving 50% or more of their value from jewels, precious metals, or precious stones, constituting, forming part of, or attached to said finished goods. Okay. Next, what is a jewel? So this refers to organic substances that have a market recognized by gem level of quality, beauty, and rarity, such as pearl, amber, and coral. Next definition, precious metals. So this refers to gold, silver, platinum, palladium, rhodium, ruthenium, iridium, and osmium at a level of purity of 500 parts per 1,000 singly or in any combination, and alloys of precious metals, solders, and plating chemicals such as rhodium and palladium, plating solution, potassium, gold cyanide containing at least 60 or 3/10%, 68 or 3/10% of gold, potassium, silver cyanide containing at least 68% of silver, and silver cyanide in salt solution containing at least 54% of silver. Okay, so why are these included, class? It's because the value of these materials or jewelry is very substantial, that sometimes it is used to cover illegal transactions. Okay, so it is included in the AMLA law. Now, precious stones, okay, these are just matters of reading, class, okay, I will leave this up to you. Classic example is diamond, okay. Next, company service providers which as a business provide any of the following services to third parties, okay. First, acting as a formation agent of juridical persons. Next, acting as or arranging for another person to act as a director or corporate secretary of a company, a partner of a partnership, or a similar position in relation to other juridical persons. So, these persons, class, more often than not, they handle the finances of the company or the corporation. So, that is why they are included in the AMLA law. Okay, so matters of reading, class, I will leave this up to you. Okay, another persons included, lawyers and accountants who provide any of the following services. First, managing of client money, securities, or other assets. Next, management of bank, savings, securities, or other assets. And then organization of contributions for the creation, operation, or management of companies. And creation, operation, or management of juridical persons or arrangement and buying and selling business entities. So the common denominator of this person's class, whether it's natural person or juridical person, is that they handle finances, they handle money, they handle profit of their clients or even of their business. So that's why they are included. Notwithstanding the foregoing, lawyers and accountants who are authorized to practice their profession in the Philippines and are engaged as independent legal professionals in relation to information concerning their clients or where disclosure of information would compromise client confidences or the attorney-client relationship are not covered persons. Okay? So, these are matters of reading, class. Okay. Now, let's define what is transaction. So, this refers to any act establishing any right or obligation or giving rise to any contractual or legal relationship between the parties thereto. It also includes any movement of funds by any means with a covered person. So, when you say transaction, it contemplates financial transaction, okay, relating to funds, relating to monetary transactions, relating to money, especially when the person you are transacting is a covered person, then it is a covered transaction, and then you will also be covered by AMLA. Now, what is covered transactions? So, a transaction in cash or other equivalent monetary instrument exceeding 500,000 pesos. Okay? So, very common, class, in bank, if your transaction, if you deposit money or withdraw money more than 500,000, then your transaction is termed a covered transaction. So it will be reported to the council, okay, to AMLA. And then transaction exceeding 1 million pesos in cases of jewelry dealers, dealers in precious metal, and dealers in precious stone, okay? So those are covered transactions. Now, let's go to the term suspicious transactions. So this refers to a transaction regardless of amount where any of the following circumstances exist, okay? So suspicious. First, there is no underlying legal or trade obligation, purpose, or economic justification. So the transaction, the money involved, has no justification why there is that amount of money to be transacted. Next, the client is not properly identified. Okay, very common. You don't know who is the depositor. Okay, you don't know the persons involved of the transaction. Next, the amount involved is not commensurate with the business or financial capacity of the client. Okay, so for example, your business is just selling sticks or selling forks. Okay, so so if your money will amount to millions, then it is a questionable transaction or source, then you will be sanctioned by the AMLA. So next, taking into account all known circumstances, it may be perceived that the client's transaction is structured in order to avoid being the subject of reporting requirements under AMLA. Okay. Next, any circumstance relating to the transaction which is observed to deviate from the profile of the client or the client's past transactions with covered persons. And then the transaction is in any way related to an unlawful activity or any money laundering activity or offense that is about to be committed is being has been committed. Okay. Next, suspicious transaction, any transaction that is similar, analogous, or identical to any of the foregoing. So, those enumerated class are what you call suspicious transactions, which is covered by AMLA. Okay. Now let's go to the definition of a client or a customer. So under the law, they refer to any person who keeps an account or otherwise transacts business with a covered person. It includes the following. First, any person or entity on whose behalf an account is maintained or a transaction is conducted, as well as the beneficiary of said transaction. So it's like you transact finances in behalf of a person. Okay, so they are called your clients. Next, beneficiary of a trust, an investment fund, or a pension fund. So they are clients or customer. Next, a company or person whose assets are managed by an asset manager. So they are clients. Another, a grantor of a trust. And then any insurance policy holder, whether actual or prospective. Okay. Now, let's go to politically exposed person or PEP. So, this refers to an individual who is or has been entrusted with prominent public position in the Philippines. Okay, first, with substantial authority over policy, operations, or the use or allocation of government-owned resources. Next, a foreign state or an international organization. So, politically exposed persons are appointed and elected public officials who, in their power, they are given to allocate government resources. Okay? like funds, like other financial resources. So the term PAP shall include immediate family members and close relationship and associates that are reputedly known to have a joint beneficial ownership of a legal entity or legal arrangement with the main principal or the PAP, okay, like their relatives, their brothers and sisters, which they have related business or they have the same companies. Next, sole beneficial ownership of a legal entity or legal arrangement that is known to exist for the benefit of the main principal or PAP, okay? So when you open a bank account and transact big amount, you will be asked by a bank to sign a form from AMLA class, okay? So that is why those PAPs or politically exposed persons can be sanctioned by AMLA, especially if their relatives handle large amount of money. Okay? Now, let's go to immediate family member. This refers to a spouse or partner, children and their spouses, and parents and parents-in-law. Now, let's go to the definition of a beneficial owner. So, this refers to any natural person who ultimately owns or controls the customer and or on whose behalf a transaction or activity is being conducted. Okay? For example, I am a lawyer. And then, in my practice, I handle funds of my clients. So, but the beneficial owner is my client, okay, of the different transactions I handle. Next, has ultimate effective control over a legal person or arrangement. Now, let's go to official document. So, this refers to any of the following identification document. Number one. For Filipino citizens, those issued by any of the following official authorities, okay? So, this is just a matter of reading class. Then, for foreign nationals, passport or alien certificate of registration. So, these are the documents needed for registration, okay? For Filipino students, school ID signed by the school. For low-risk customers, any document or information reduced in writing. Okay, these are just matters of reading. Now, let's go to monetary instrument. So, shall include but is not limited to the following. Coins or currency of legal tender of the Philippines or of any other country. Okay. Next, credit instruments including bank deposits, financial interest, royalty, commissions, and other intangible property. Next, draft checks and notes, okay, relating to finances. Next, stocks or shares, participation or interest in a corporation or in a commercial enterprise or profit-making venture, and evidence by a certificate, contract, instrument, whether written or electronic in character, including those enumerated in Section 3 of the Securities Regulations Commission, okay? So, these are just matters of reading class. I will leave this up to you. Okay. Next definition, property. So, when you say property, this can be personal or real properties. So, refers to anything or item of value, real or personal, tangible or intangible, or any interest therein, or any benefit, privilege, claim, or right with respect thereto, including personal property, like proceeds derived therefrom, traceable to any unlawful activity such as but not limited to cash, jewelry, precious metals, and other similar items, works of art such as paintings, sculptures, antiques, treasures, and other similar precious objects. Okay, So the common denominator of this class are items with value. Okay, so they are worth something. They are worth a substantial amount of money or cash. Okay. So these are just matters of reading class. Real estate also is included, like lands, constructed or crops growing, or any interest standing upon the record of the registry of deeds in the name of the party against whom the asset preservation order is issued. Okay, so these are just matters of reading. What is essential class is that there are real properties like lands and personal properties like movables, like cash and other goods. Okay, now let's go to the word proceeds. So this refers to an amount derived or realized from any unlawful activity. So next, monetary instrument or property related to an unlawful activity refers to all proceeds of an unlawful activity, all monetary, financial, or economic means, devices, accounts, documents, papers, items, or things used in or having any relation to any unlawful activity. Okay. Next, all monies, expenditures, payment, disbursement, cost, outlays, charges, accounts, refund, and other similar items for the financing, operation, and maintenance of any unlawful activity. Okay. So the common denominator of this class is that there is financial gains on unlawful activity. Okay. So mostly these are enumerations of the things that a person can derive financial gains using unlawful activities. Okay, so these are just matters of reading. Related accounts, matter of reading. Next, let's go to materially linked accounts. So these are accounts which includes the following: all accounts or monetary instruments under the name of the person whose accounts, monetary instruments, or properties are the subject of freeze order or an order of inquiry. Okay, so the council class, which implements AMLA, has the power to inquire on your assets and bank accounts. And if they have probable cause to prosecute you for violations of the AMLA law, then they can file in court a freeze order in order to freeze your assets. Okay, you cannot withdraw your money in the banks, you cannot sell your house, you cannot sell your lands. Okay, these are just matters of reading class. Okay, I will leave this up to you. Who is an offender? Refers to any person who commits a money laundering offense. Okay. Now, what is an unlawful activity? So, the following class are the unlawful activity contemplated by law where financial gains can be committed. Okay. That's why they are sanctioned by this law. So this refers to any act or omission or series or combination thereof involving or having direct relation to the following. First, kidnapping for ransom. Okay. Next, violation of Republic Act number 9165, otherwise known as the Comprehensive Dangerous Drugs Act. Okay. Next, violation of Anti-Graft and Corrupt Practices Act. Next, plunder. Okay, or violation against Republic Act number 7080 as amended. Okay, violation of the crimes or felonies under the revised penal code, which said violation, the outcome of which will be the perpetrator will gain money. Okay, like robbery, extortion. Okay. Another illegal gambling like wetting and masyaw, okay? Punish as illegal gambling under PD 1602. Next, violation of piracy on the high seas, sanctioned by the revised penal code as amended by PD number 532. Next, qualified theft, okay? Next, swindling and other forms of swindling, sanctioned under articles 315 and 316 respectively of the revised penal code. Another act sanctioned by this rule is smuggling, okay? Sanctioned by Republic Act number 455 and under Republic Act number 1937 as amended, otherwise known as the Tariff and Customs Code of the Philippines, okay? Next, violation of Republic Act number 8792, otherwise known as the Electronic Commerce Act of 2000. Next, hijacking and other violations under Republic Act number 6235, otherwise known as the Anti-Hijacking Law. Okay. Next, destructive arson and murder as defined under the revised penal code as amended. Next, terrorism and conspiracy to commit terrorism as defined and penalized under Section 3 and 4 of the Republic Act 9372. Next, illegal activity or unlawful activity, financing of terrorism under Section 4, and offenses punishable under Sections 5, 6, 7, and 8 of Republic Act number 10, 16, 8, otherwise known as the Terrorism Financing Prevention and Suppression Act of 2012. Next is bribery, corruption of public officers, sanctioned by the revised penal code. Frauds and illegal exactions, sanctioned by the revised penal code. Malversation of public funds, forgeries and counterfeiting. Violations against Anti-Trafficking in Persons Act, okay, as amended. And then violations of the revised forestry code of the Philippines as amended. Violations of the Philippines Fisheries Code of 1999. Violations of the Philippine Mining Act of 1995. Violations against Wildlife Resources Conservation and Protection Act. Okay, I will make an example class because there are many violations. For example, this act, the Wildlife Resources Conservation and Protection Act. For example, there is an endangered species. For example, a snake. Okay. And this snake, because there is only 5 remaining in the world, so you caught one and then you sell it at a very substantial amount, say 1 million or 2 million, okay? So the proceeds of that, because it is an illegal act, because wildlife, especially endangered species, are protected by law. So the profit therefrom will be sanctioned by AMLA and you will be prosecuted based on this law. Okay. Next, violation of National Caves and Cave Resources Management Protection Act. Next, violation of Anti-Carnapping Act of 2002. And then violation of Presidential Decree Number 1866 as amended, otherwise known as the decree codifying the law on illegal and lawful possession, manufacture, dealing in, acquisition or disposition of firearms, ammunition or explosive. Violation against anti-fencing law. Okay, so if there are items which are proceeds of a criminal act, okay, like theft or robbery, and then you sell it, and then as a buyer also, you will be prosecuted, okay? Next, violation of Migrant Workers and Overseas Filipinos Act of 1995, and then violation of Intellectual Property Code of the Philippines as amended, Violations against Anti-Photo and Video Voyeurism Act of 2009. Violation of the Anti-Child Pornography Act of 2009. Okay. Violation of Special Protection of Children Against Abuse, Exploitation, and Discrimination. Okay. So in our previous discussion class, the law against human trafficking, the proceeds of which is the one sanctioned by AMLA. However, there are in that law, the Human Trafficking Act, there are also corresponding penalties. Okay, so you can use that law together with this law. Okay, as many violations and as many law violated, you can use all those laws in order to prosecute the perpetrator, because these are special laws. Okay, so unlike the revised penal code, if a certain act and then sanctioned by the different felonies under the revised penal code, then they can be compressed into a complex crime, okay, and so on and so forth. However, in special laws, you can prosecute it under this law and then under other laws, because it has its own rules and regulation, okay, in addition with the revised penal code. Okay, so as many laws as possible, you can prosecute the perpetrator. Okay, next, sanction by Securities Regulation Code of 2000. Felonies or offenses of a nature similar to the aforementioned unlawful activities that are punishable under the penal laws of the other countries. So, in determining whether or not a felony or offense punishable under the penal laws of other countries is of similar nature, okay? So, the requirement that the offense is of similar nature as to constitute an unlawful activity under AMLA, okay? So, the nomenclature of said felony or offense need not be identical to any of the unlawful activities listed above. Okay. Now, what is the definition of probable cause? So, this refers to such facts and circumstances which would lead a reasonably discreet, prudent, or cautious man to believe that any monetary instrument or property sought to be frozen, inquired into, or preserved is in any way related to any unlawful activity and or money laundering offenses. Okay, so when you prosecute, it must be based on a probable cause that a crime is indeed committed and the perpetrator is liable. Now let's go to rule 4, or the money laundering. So how does money laundering committed? So, any person who, knowing that any monetary instrument or property represents, involves, or relates to the proceeds of any unlawful activity, okay? So, money laundering is committed by when a person transacts said monetary instrument or property, converts, transfers, disposes of, moves, acquires, possesses, or uses any said monetary instrument or property, okay? Conceals or disguises the true nature, source, location, disposition, movement, or ownership of rights with respect to said monetary instrument or property. Okay? So, the common denominator of this class is when you handle the transaction of the said unlawful activity. Okay? So, you convert, you transfer, you dispose, or move the money. So, you are sanctioned, your acts are sanctioned by law, okay? Or you attempt to conspire to commit money laundering offenses. You aid, abet, assist in, or counsels the commission of the money laundering offenses referred to in sections 1, 2, 3, and above, okay? So, the common denominator class, you are involved with the processing of the profits of the unlawful activity. So, you are committing money laundering. Okay? I will leave this up to you, class. These are just matters of reading. Okay? So any covered person who knowing that a covered or suspicious transaction is required under the AMLA to be reported to AMLC fails to do so. So you can be investigated also, class, if you fail to disclose the nature of the transaction. For example, you have a land, a parcel of land, and then you sold that parcel of land, and the amount is, for example, 50 million. Okay, that's a legitimate transaction. But if you fail to produce evidence in the bank, like deed of absolute sale or other documents, then you can be investigated. Okay, not because you are into illegal transactions or unlawful activities, but because you failed to produce necessary document to justify the money. Okay, remember what I said earlier, the ceiling is 500,000 per day. Okay, when you transact in a bank, so above that you need to justify why you have that such amount. Okay, it doesn't mean you will be prosecuted, class. It is just that you need to justify the money, even if 50 million, 100 million, 1 billion, no problem. As long as there is justification, okay? You sold your land, you sold your properties, you sold jewelries, your business, you are into big business, okay? So there's no problem if it exceeds 500,000, as long as there are proper documentation and justification, okay? Now, let's go to Rule 5, Jurisdiction over Money Laundering Cases. So, Regional Trial Court. The Regional Trial Court shall have the jurisdiction to try money laundering cases committed by private individuals and public officers not covered by the jurisdiction of the Sandigan Bayan. Okay, so original jurisdiction, class, is RTC, okay, for private individuals. In the other hand, Sandigan Bayan shall have jurisdiction to try money laundering cases committed by public officers under its jurisdiction and private persons who are in conspiracy with such public officers. Okay, so if the persons involved are public officers, class, okay, for example, plunder case, graft and corruption, then the proper jurisdiction is Sandigan Bayan. So even if you are a private individual, but you are in cahoots or in conspiracy with a public officer, then you will be tried in the Sandigan Bayan. Okay? Now, Rule 6, Prosecution of Money Laundering Cases. So, independent proceedings. The prosecution of money laundering and the unlawful activity shall proceed independently. Any person may be charged with and convicted of both money laundering and unlawful activity. Okay? So like what I said earlier, if you are also prosecuted by, for example, Human Trafficking Act, okay? So the proceedings will go independently because like what I said, it is a special law and it has its own penalties, its own violations, own sanctions. So, for example, you kidnap a person, and then in order to make money, you ask for a ransom. Okay, so you can be prosecuted with this law for your money laundering act of asking money, and you can also be prosecuted by the revised penal code because of kidnapping. Okay. And other extortions. Okay? Next, separate and distinct elements. So the elements of money laundering are separate and distinct from the elements of unlawful activity. Okay? Like what I have discussed earlier. So you can proceed independently with different bases. Okay? Money laundering, revised penal code, and other special laws. Okay? Violated by the perpetrator. Okay, so the elements of unlawful activity, including the identity of the perpetrators and the details of the commission of the unlawful activity, need not be established by proof beyond reasonable doubt in the case for money laundering. Okay? Next, knowledge. The element of knowledge may be established by direct or circumstantial evidence. The rules of procedure, the rules of court shall govern all proceedings concerning the prosecution of money laundering. Okay? So, the rules of court will apply when it comes to prosecution of violators which violated money laundering law or AMLA. Rule number 7, Anti-Money Laundering Council. Okay? So, the AMLC or the Council for Brevity is composed of the Governor of the BSP as Chairperson and the Commissioner of the Insurance Commission and the Chairperson of the Securities and Exchange Commission as members. Okay? So, these are just matters of reading class. I will leave this up to you. Okay? Their decision, their functions. Okay? I will upload this to your notes. And considering this is an organic law, okay, I found this in the internet. So, for intellectual property purposes, I do not own this. Okay? I'm only using this for purposes of discussion. Okay? So, this is not mine. This is from the council. The AMLA council. Okay? So, just a matter of reading class. I will leave this up to you. Composition of AMLC Secretariat. Okay, the AMLC shall assisted by AMLC Secretariat in the discharge of its function. Okay, so composed of the director and at least 5 members. Okay, and members. So these are just matters of reading class. I will leave this up to you. Now, let's go to rule number 9, the preventive measures. So, customer due diligence. So, how do you prevent investigation or being prosecuted by AMLA? First is conduct due diligence as a customer. So, covered person shall establish and record the true identity of their clients. So, I am a lawyer and then in behalf of my clients, I transacted something. Okay, I must perform due diligence as a lawyer. For example, this client has a parcel of land that he wants to sell. And of course, the value of his land, because it's a prime lot, it would cost around 50 million. Okay, so there's no problem with that class. Okay, even if it reached billions of pesos, there's no problem. As long as there are proper documents and the transaction is legitimate. Of course, he is the owner of the land. And he sells that land. So, it is a legitimate transaction. However, for purposes of AMLA, in compliance with AMLA, I need, as a lawyer, to justify the money involved. Because it's 50 million. So, either I submit a contract to sell or a deed of absolute sale or other documents. Okay? That will justify the transaction. So that's how I will conduct due diligence. Okay, make sure that the identity of the clients are properly identified. They are real persons. The transaction is real, not bogus. Okay, so on and so forth. Okay, so these are just matters of reading class. So how do you identify your customer? First, there must be face-to-face contact, okay? You can read this. This is just a matter of reading. And then, know the basic information of your client, okay? The date and birth, okay, the address. These are just matters of reading class. Their government IDs like TIN, SSS, etc. Okay, matters of reading. I will leave this up to you, okay? Customer information like name of the entity, if the customer is a juridical person, its registration, okay? The signatory, their official address, okay? So, So what are the documents necessary, like the DTI, the SEC, the articles of incorporation, and so on and so forth. So what is essential, class, in due diligence, okay, is you present necessary document in order to prove the legitimacy of your transaction. So if your transaction is justified, then of course, AMLA will not touch it, even though the transaction involves billions of pesos, okay? As long that it is justified, okay? So these are just matters of reading, okay? Okay, matter of reading, class. Outsourcing the conduct of customer identification, you hire an investigator or third party for due diligence. And then identification and verification of a beneficial owner, trustee, nominee, or agent. Okay, so these are just matters of reading. You also conduct a risk assessment. So what does risk assessment implies? So covered person shall develop clear, written, and graduated customer acceptance policies and procedures, including a set of criteria for customers that are likely to pose low, normal, or high risk to their operations. So the criteria may include the nature of the service or product to be availed of by the customers. Okay. Next, the purpose of the account or transaction, the amount of funds to be deposited by a customer, the size of transaction undertaken, the regularity or duration of the transaction, the fact that a customer came from a high-risk jurisdiction, the existence of suspicious transaction indicators, and such other factors that other factors the covered persons may deem reasonable or necessary to consider in assessing the risk of a customer to money laundering. Okay, so when you say risk assessment, class, you document everything. So that's the essence. Okay, there should be a written agreement, because the banks will also ask legitimate documents from you in order to justify the money or the transactions. Okay, so these are just matters of reading, class. Enhanced due diligence, I will leave this up to you. Okay, ongoing monitoring of customers' accounts and transactions, just a matter of reading. So there are also prohibited accounts. So when you face prohibited accounts as an individual who transact in behalf of others, you must not allow prohibited accounts in your transactions, okay? So what are these prohibited accounts? Like anonymous accounts and accounts under fictitious names, okay? It's not allowed. Then numbered accounts. When you say numbered accounts, except non-checking, numbered accounts shall not be allowed, okay? Very important, record keeping. Because documentation is important. It is essential. It is necessary for justification purposes. Okay? So just a matter of reading, class. And then reporting. If you are a covered person, so just a matter of reading. So the contents of the reports are also illustrated. So these are just matters of reading. There is what you call a safe harbor provision in your contract. So in the content of a safe harbor provision, it contemplates that no administrative, criminal, or civil proceeding shall lie against any person for having made a CTR or STR in the regular performance of his duties and in good faith, whether or not such reporting results in any criminal prosecution under AMLA or any Philippine law. So this is like your for your safety, okay, for your protection, safe harbor provision. And then you enroll to the council in the reporting system. Okay, now let's go to rule 9-A, preventive measures for specific customers and activity. Okay, so if you are a politically exposed person, covered person shall establish and record the true and full identity of politically exposed persons. as well as their immediate family members and entities related to them. So in case of the domestic PEPs or persons who have been entrusted with a prominent function by an international organization, in addition to performing the applicable due diligence measure under Rule 9, covered person shall take reasonable measures to determine whether a customer or beneficial owner is a PEP. Okay, the common denominator of this class is documentation, okay? You document everything and make sure that the documentation is specific and they are real facts and information, okay? You conduct due diligence, okay? So, these are just matters of reading, class. Okay, I will leave this up to you. Correspondent bank requirements also. These are just matters of reading, okay? If it is a shell company, a bank, a bearer share entity. So, again, conduct due diligence, document everything, be specific. Real information should be written, okay? These are just matters of reading. Wire fund transfer. So, covered person shall establish policies and procedures designed to prevent wire fund transfers from being utilized for money laundering activities, which shall include but are not limited to the following, okay? So, these are just matters of reading, class. I will leave this up to you. Yeah. So now let's go to Rule 10, freeze order. So if the council determines that the proceeds or the money involved comes from an unlawful activity, then the council will apply for a freeze order in court. So what is a freeze order? So, upon verified ex parte petition by the council and after determination that probable cause exists that any monetary instrument or property is in any way related to an unlawful activity, the Court of Appeals may issue a freeze order which shall be effective immediately, directing the concerned covered person and government agency to desist from allowing any transaction, withdrawal, transfer, removal, conversion, concealment, or other disposition of the subject monetary instrument or property. Also, so the properties is being freezed. Okay, the word itself, freeze order. So when there is a freeze order against your assets, because the council believes that it is the result of an unlawful activity, then you cannot withdraw your money in the banks. You cannot sell your properties like lands, your house. So, all your assets will be freezed, okay? So, freezing of related accounts and materially linked accounts. So, considering the intricate and diverse web of interlocking accounts that a person may create in different covered persons, and the high probability that these accounts are utilized to divert, move, conceal, and disguise the monetary instrument or property subject of the freeze order, the AMLC may include its petition the freezing of related and materially linked accounts. So, even though accounts not under your name, but AMLC believe that such account is materially linked to your account, okay, then it will also be freezed. And then the Court of Appeal shall resolve the petition to freeze within 24 hours from filing thereof. Effectivity of freeze order. So, the freeze order shall be effective immediately and shall not exceed 6 months, depending upon the circumstances of the case. On motion of the council filed before the expiration of the original period of freeze order, the court may, for good cause shown, extend its effectivity. Upon the timely filing of such motion and pending resolution by the Court of Appeals, the freeze order shall remain effective, okay? So, even if there's no prior criminal charge, pendency of or conviction necessary. So, even if there is no criminal charge yet, then the council can apply for a freeze order, okay? Because the purpose of which is to stop the utilization of said account, okay? To preserve the status quo of the account. And then rules of procedure, proceedings for issuance of freeze order shall be governed by the rules of procedure in cases of civil forfeiture, asset preservation and freezing of monetary instrument, property or proceeds representing, involving, or relating to an unlawful activity or money laundering offense under RA 9160 as amended. However, there's a remedy if you are the person whose property is being freezed. Okay, you file a motion to lift. A person whose monetary instrument or property has been frozen may file a motion to lift the freeze order. The court must resolve the motion before the expiration of the freeze order. Okay? So, lifting the effects of the freeze order. So, the freeze order shall be deemed ipso facto lifted after its expiration. So, 6 months class. So, if it reached 6 months and there's no motion for extension, then ipso facto. So, when you say ipso facto, immediately, the freeze order will be lifted, okay? Unless a money laundering complaint against the person whose monetary instrument or property was frozen, or a petition for civil forfeiture against the frozen monetary instrument or property has been filed, which case the freeze order shall remain effective until the money laundering case is terminated or an asset preservation order is issued respectively, okay? Can a freeze order be enjoined? Okay, TRO, temporary restraining order against a freeze order. Answer is no court shall issue a temporary restraining order or a writ of injunction against any freeze order except the Supreme Court. Okay, so the answer is yes, as long as you filed it in the Supreme Court and you have good reason so that the Supreme Court will allow said injunction. Okay. So, duties of covered persons and concerned government agencies upon receipt of a freeze order. So, the primordial duty is to implement the freeze order. So, upon receipt of the notice of the freeze order, the covered person and government agency concerned shall immediately freeze the monetary instrument or property subject thereof and shall immediately desist from and not allow any transaction, withdrawal, transfer, removal, conversion, and other movement or concealment thereof, okay? So, the purpose of which is to preserve the status quo, okay? To avoid further using of the unlawful proceeds, okay? So, these are just matters of reading, class. Matters of reading, I will leave this up to you, okay? Matters of reading. So, the purpose of our discussion today is just to have a bird's eye view or an overview of this law. If you have any question, feel free to message me. Okay. Next is bank inquiry. So, bank inquiry with court order. Remember, class, there is a bank secrecy law. Okay. The purpose is for the protection of the depositor. And of course, bank secrecy law is very strict. Okay, the law is imbued with public policy. However, if there is a bank inquiry with court order, then the bank should give the details of the transaction, okay, by virtue of this law. So this is the exception class of the bank secrecy law of the Philippines. So, notwithstanding the provisions of Republic Act 1405 as amended, Republic Act 6426 as amended, and then Republic Act 8791 and other laws, the council may inquire into or examine any particular deposit or investment account, including related accounts with any banking institutions or non-bank financial institution. upon order by the Court of Appeals based on ex parte application. Okay? However, class, inquiry is not automatic. There must be a court order. There must be an application. Okay? In order to inquire the details of the bank. Okay? So, in cases of violation of AMLA, when it has been established that probable cause exists, that the deposits or investments involved, including related accounts, are in any way related to an unlawful activity or a money laundering offense. Okay, so period to resolve such application is within 24 hours from filing therefrom. Okay, so these are just matters of reading, class. So what if there is a bank inquiry without court order? So the council shall issue a resolution authorizing the council secretariat to inquire into or examine any particular deposit or investment account, including related accounts, with any banking institution or non-bank financial institution and their subsidiaries and affiliates when it has been established that probable cause exists that deposits or investments involved, including related accounts, are in any way related to the following unlawful activities. Again, this is an exception, okay? Like kidnapping for ransom, okay? The violation for Dangerous Drugs Act, okay? Hijacking and other violations, so we have discussed this earlier. Terrorism and then financing of terrorism. So, at their own initiative, they can inquire, okay? So, duties of the covered persons under receipt of bank inquiry. So, if a bank receives an order, then of course, the bank should comply. And then a certified true copy of the documents pertaining to deposit, investment account, or transaction subject of the bank inquiry shall be submitted to council secretariat within 5 working days from receipt of the court order or the council resolution. Now, what is the authority of the Bangko Sentral ng Pilipinas to inquire into or examine bank accounts? So, in the course of a periodic or special examination, the BSP may inquire into or examine bank accounts including customer identification, account opening, and transaction documents for the purpose of checking compliance by covered persons under its supervision. Okay? So, the BSP also has the limited power to inquire bank accounts for purposes of checking, okay, but not for purposes of prosecution because it is outside their power. Now, let's go to asset forfeiture. So, if upon investigation and upon dissolution of the court that indeed such profits or such money are the product of unlawful activity, then it will be forfeited in favor of the government. Okay, so civil forfeiture. Upon determination that probable cause exists that any monetary instrument or property is in any way related to an unlawful activity or a money laundering offense, the council shall file with the RTC through the Office of the Solicitor General a verified petition for civil forfeiture. So equal value asset. So, these are the contents of the petition, class, okay? So, these are just matters of reading. So, even if there's no prior charges, the council can file it directly, okay? Rules of procedure, it will be governed by the rule of procedure in cases of civil forfeiture, asset prevention, and freezing of monetary instruments. So, this is just a matter of reading, class. So if the property was not preserved, then payment in lieu of forfeiture. Okay, so the persons, the violator, will pay instead of the item or the property be forfeited. Okay. And the basis is the amount equal to the value of said monetary instrument or property. Now, let's go to request for assistance. request for assistance from a foreign state. So where a foreign state makes a request for assistance in the investigation or prosecution of money laundering offense, the council may execute the request or refuse to execute the same and inform the foreign state of any valid reason for not executing the request or for delaying the execution thereof. The principles of mutuality and reciprocity shall at all times be recognized. Okay? So they can act accordingly, or if they decline, they must justify their action. Powers of the council to act on a request for assistance from a foreign state. So the following are the powers of the council: tracking down, freezing, restraining, and seizing assets alleged to be proceeds of any unlawful activity under the procedures laid down in AMLA. Okay? So they can act accordingly. Okay? They can give information. They can apply for freeze order at the behest or at the behalf of the other foreign state. We need to recognize this relationship because we are signatories of treaties, class. Okay, remember that general principles and treaties become becomes part of the law of our lands. So that is the reason behind. Okay. So if the council also wants to ask assistance from foreign states, then here is the procedure. Okay. So these are just matters of reading, class. So requirements for request for mutual assistance. Just read this. Authentication of documents, very important. Okay. And then supplementary application of the revised rules of court. So once again, if there are gray areas, the revised rules of court can have a supplementary application. Okay. Authority to assist United Nations and other international organizations, extradition. So the Philippines shall negotiate for the inclusion of money laundering offenses among the extraditable offenses in all future treaties. Okay? So if the person involved is a foreigner and then he's found here in the Philippines, then he can be extradited. Okay? So that he can be prosecuted in his or her home country. Okay? So, the penal provisions, class. The following are the penalties to be imposed on persons convicted of money laundering. Okay? Penalties for Section 4, A, B, C, and D of the AMLA. The penalty of imprisonment ranging from 7 to 14 years and a fine of not less than 3 million but not more than twice the value of the monetary instrument or property involved in the offense shall be imposed upon a person convicted under sections 4, A, B, C, and D of the AMLA as amended. So, remember, class, in Criminal Law 1, we have discussed that the subsidiary imprisonment. So, if a person, when there is a fine as a penalty, for example, in this case, 3 million, and the perpetrator has no money, then this penalty, this fine, will be converted into imprisonments. Okay? So that's the term subsidiary imprisonment. Okay, next, penalties for sections 4E and F of the AMLA. So imprisonment from 4 to 7 years and a fine of not less than 1,500,000 pesos, but not more than 3 million pesos. Okay? So these are just matters of reading, class. Okay, I will leave this up to you. There are also administrative sanctions. So if you are part of the government, of course, you will be administratively liable. Okay? There is also a provision against political persecution. So the AMLA and these implementing rules and regulation shall not be used for political persecution or harassment or as an instrument to hamper competition in trade and commerce, of course, because government resources and even big businesses involves not just millions but billions. So that's why This law is also weaponized by others. Okay? So you must have basic knowledge of this law in order to protect yourselves also. Okay? So restitution for any aggrieved party shall be governed the provision of the new civil code. So anti-money laundering programs, just a matter of reading, okay, they make a procedure, okay, they formulate and implement rules and regulation, they update the law, they train their personnel, okay. Next, compliance checking and investigation. So compliance checking, authority of the supervising authorities to assist the council in compliance checking. So the supervising authorities shall assist the council in checking the compliance of covered persons under their respective jurisdiction on the requirements of AMLA and its IRR and other council issuances. Okay. Authority to investigate. The council through its secretariat shall investigate suspicious transactions and covered transactions deemed suspicious, money laundering activities and other violation of AMLA. Okay. Of course, you should put in your mind that if your transaction in a single day in a bank also would exceed 500,000, then you can be investigated. However, you just need to present justifiable documents. Okay, so these are just matters of reading class. Okay. Next, Rule 20, non-intervention in the operations of the BIR. So, the council shall not intervene or participate in any manner in the operations of the Bureau of Internal Revenue. And then, prohibition against ex post facto laws and bill of attainder. So, the constitutional injunction against ex post facto laws and the bills of attainders shall be respected in the implementation of AMLA, its IRR and other issuances. Okay. So miscellaneous provisions like the budget, costs and expenses, information security and confidentiality. Okay, these are just matters of reading class. So separability clause. If any provisions of the IRR or the application thereof to any persons or circumstance is held to be invalid, the other provisions of the IRR and the application of such provisions or rule to other persons or circumstances shall not be affected thereby. Okay. Then repealing clause and then effectivity. So basically class, the purpose of this law is to sanction illegal or unlawful activities that involves money laundering. Okay. In order to protect our citizens from unscrupulous persons, okay? And in order to protect also legitimate transactions. So I think, class, that's it. That's the overview of AMLA. If you have any question, feel free to message me and contact me directly. And I have also uploaded this note in the files for your reference. So thank you guys and God bless us all. Bye.